Great Britain.
How did you shoot him?
Shot him.
Did you think about it before you pulled the trigger?
No.
Any hesitation in pulling the trigger?
No.
Through the 70s and 80s, hundreds of loyalists joined the paramilitaries. They feared the IRA was winning and the government was bent on selling them out to a united Ireland. Anywhere else, young men like Billy Giles from a law-abiding family might never have done what they did.
Did you say anything to him before you kill him?
No, it wasn't. It was quick and it was direct. That's what it was quick and it was dirty. And the guy lost his life.
The loyalist paramilitaries of the UVF and UDA could not exist without support from their tightly knit communities. These are ordinary people joined together by uncertainty and fear. They see the paramilitaries and their political allies as defenders of their heritage and their right to remain British. Loyalists feel they've been under siege from IRA murderers and treacherous British governments. For more than 30 years, Ian Paisley has given loud voice to loyalist fears as no other can. Whenever there were suspicions that Downing Street and Dublin were doing deals, Paisley roared out the warning.
We will not have a united Ireland!
Northern Ireland's Prime Minister, Brian Faulkner, had just signed an agreement with the Irish Republic.
I say to the Dublin government, Mr. Faulkner says it hands across the border to Dublin. I say if they don't behave themselves in the south, it will be shots across the border!
But a few months later, it was not shots, but bombs across the border, although Paisley had nothing to do with them. The UVF planted 3 car bombs in the south. There were no warnings. 33 people were killed, 26 in Dublin, the biggest loss of life in a single day in the whole of the conflict. One victim was preparing for her wedding.
She was 6 weeks after being married. Making all our preparations, her wedding dress, her wedding cake, presents in the house. The last thing Horton and I done was wrote out her invitation cards, 120 invitation cards, on the Thursday night before she was killed.
Why did the UVF bomb Dublin?
I think what they were doing was returning the serve.
Returning the serve?
Yeah, well, that's they would perhaps say, I'm not advocating bombing anywhere. What I'm saying to you is that what we had witnessed here was the killing of our people. Now, do you know how it feels? I think that was the sense. Do you know how it feels?
Returning the serfs, slaughtering 26 innocent people?
You ask me a question, I give you an answer, and determining why people do things.
The slaughter was carried out by two UVF units, one from the Shankill Road and one from Porter Down. The bombers were never charged.
All I can say is, for myself and my wife, and I'd say the children too, that there's not a day goes by when we don't think of that child.
I was in Belfast around this time and watched chaos erupt outside the Stormont Parliament. Loyalists had disrupted the assembly that was part of a new political initiative agreed by the British and Irish governments at Sunningdale. As ever, Ian Paisley led the protest. To Loyalists, the new structures were a sellout, a political link with the South, and a government in which Catholics and Protestants shared power. I stood in the middle of the scrum and asked Paisley if he was satisfied now that he had wrecked the assembly. He didn't like my question and told me what to do.
Go down and photograph the bayonets of the British Army. Yeah. 1,000 army men. And if that, sir, is the sort of thing you think you'll get democracy in Northern Ireland, get you back to England.
A Westminster election followed, and Paisley and the other unionist parties joined forces to oppose Sunningdale and power sharing.
We had just had an election when the United Ulster Unionist Council, which I helped to form, had won a magnificent victory, winning all 11 seats. He swept the board. What did the British government do? Ignored the ballot box. And the people of Northern Ireland said, we've had enough.
Loyalists, led by the shipyard workers, came out on strike. It was organised by the Ulster Workers' Council, the UWC, a coalition of workers, politicians and paramilitaries. Their purpose was to paralyse the province and bring down the new agreement. Initially, support for the strike was lukewarm, but intimidation made it stick.
We decided we were going to have to put up barricades, and we couldn't be seen to be provoking the security forces. But at the same time, we had to get the message through to our own people. So there was psychological intimidation in those couple of those first two or three days.
Most of the members of the Ulster Defence Association decided to follow the plan of not going to work.
And that meant that they deterred, stopped, intimidated people from going to work.
They advised people and they asked people to support the strike. They done everything possible. You can call it intimidation, you can call it what you want, but it still goes back to the most important thing. Nobody was hurt.
And it worked.
And it worked.
Within days, Loyalist support became nigh universal as politicians and paramilitaries marched side by side. Ian Paisley and Glenn Barr, Bill Craig and Andy Tyrie. The message on the street was clear. Loyalists of all persuasions were in revolt. Intimidation was no longer necessary.
I don't believe that the strike succeeded because of intimidation. The strike succeeded because the people of Ulster were determined to overthrow the Sunningdale Agreement.
The paramilitaries effectively ran the strike, with the politicians in step behind them. The UDA ensured that certain individuals knew their place and were kept in it.
Andy Terry and Glennie Barr asked me to do security at the front door of the room. And when I asked, were they expecting anyone else, they said, Ian Paisley's coming, but he's too late. This meeting's starting at 10 a.m. So I ask again, what happens if Paisley comes and says, let him in? Keep him standing there.
We broke for a cup of tea. I come back into the room with my tea, and Paisley was sitting in my chair. And I asked him to move. And he started to decry the fact that he wasn't going to come into the meeting, that two of these ruffians had stopped him outside. And I had suggested to him that he wasn't as big a man in the room as he might be outside, and would he please move? And he made an excuse that he had a bad back, and the chair that he was sitting in, which was my chair, was the most comfortable in the room. So we physically lifted him, chair and all, and moved him down the table. And he then got the message that he wasn't in charge of the strike, nor was he going to be allowed to be in charge of the strike.
Troops tried to run the silent power stations, but found they couldn't on their own. They also tried to keep the filling stations open, but the strikers controlled the petrol.
The army couldn't have coped with the situation that would develop. And the army were sensible enough to stand back.
Harold Wilson had just become the new Labour Prime Minister. His Secretary of State, Merlin Rees, knew the strike had become a mass protest and had no wish to make it worse. He advised Wilson to choose his words with care. Wilson ignored the advice.
People who benefit from all this now viciously defy Westminster, purporting to act as though they were an elected government. People who spend their lives sponging on Westminster and British democracy and then systematically assault democratic methods. Who do these people think they are?
Arthur, great stuff. This is fantastic. We'll make him an honorary member of the UDA after this, you know. And, of course, the time we went to the streets, the people were outraged at being called spongers. And I think that is the best thing happened to them. Anything after that, we couldn't go wrong. And the response to that, of course, was the massive turnout of farmers and all the rest to Stormont, and the whole of East Belfast was totally blocked in.
The province was paralysed. Stormont's new power-sharing government resigned, and Sunningdale was consigned to history.
Would you please stop on this?
Loyalists had defied Westminster, and through a combination of sheer numbers, industrial muscle, and paramilitary power, had effectively taken over the state.
Wasn't it a coup d'etat?
No.
But you took over the running of the state. You defied the wishes of the elected representatives and the government at Westminster.
Well, they had defied our wishes as the majority of the people.
But you professed to be loyalists and loyal to the Crown and loyal to the government.
Well, the government wasn't loyal to the Crown. The government compromised the Crown.
The strikers had won. Loyalists sent Westminster an ominous message. Any government that sought to override the wishes of Ulster's Protestant majority did so at its peril. In the wake of the strike, violence on both sides escalated. The IRA believed victory was in sight. Loyalists were determined to show the IRA it couldn't win. They returned to killing Catholics. The UVF hit the enemy in its heartland. To them, the enemy was anyone living there. At this junction, at 7:31 morning, the UVF drove by and shot dead two young Catholics.
The two young men who were killed were both innocent Catholics. Had nothing to do with the IRA. They were not Republicans. They were just two innocent Catholics walking along Divis Street. They were shot dead by you and your colleagues.
Well, I mean, I suppose that some people could say that, but...
Well, not just say that. That's what happened. That was true, wasn't it?
Well, I mean, yeah, well, I mean, you know, it was 25 years ago or
still
whatever.
Happened.
Yeah, that happened.
Grieving families?
Yeah.
Loved ones lost?
Well, I recognise all of that happened, and I recognise that it was part of the conflict.
Billy Hutchinson was sentenced to life for the double murder. Today, he's a leading Loyalist politician committed to the peace process.
Do you regret what you did? Do you regret your part in the murder of those two young men?
No, I don't have any regrets for anything I've done. I believe that I was a part of a war, and that war had to be fought. And what we need to do is to build the future. And I certainly don't regret anything that I've done in the past.
By the beginning of 1975, the IRA called a truce during secret talks with the British government. The MI6 officer, Michael Oakley, personally conducted the face-to-face meetings with the IRA. Rumours of a secret deal fueled Loyalist suspicions that a united Ireland was just around the corner. The UVF bombed Conway's bar in Greencastle to provoke the IRA into breaking its ceasefire. The UVF had bombed the bar a year earlier and killed two Catholics. This latest attack on Conway's was the fifth in 5 years.
I had been told that it was an IRA meeting taking place. I had been told that there was a security IRA presence on the bar.
Did you care if it wasn't a meeting of Republicans, it was just a Catholic bar?
I didn't particularly care.
It was a Catholic target?
Yeah.
Sectarian target?
Yeah.
The bomb went off prematurely, killing one of the UVF bombers and a woman whose daughter was an IRA prisoner.
What was the bomb?
It was a gas cylinder.
Gas cylinder. How big?
Well, we were told that it would be equivalent of 50-pound explosive.
What damage would that have done?
I think it would have, had the bomb went off properly, I think it would have, in those days, it was time to turn it into a car park.
Flattened it.
Yep.
Basically, it was an operation that went wrong, in the sense that whenever we'd got to the bar, the bomb had exploded and killed two people, and I had came around in the debris of the bar.
Martin Snodden and Eddie Kinner were both given life sentences for murder.
How did you react when you heard that a woman had been killed by your bomb?
I was devastated, to be honest. As far as I was concerned, I was going out to attack and kill the IRA. It wasn't my intentions to kill any woman or any other civilian.
As far as I was concerned, I was copying, I was doing exactly what was being done to my community, on our community.
Tit for tat.
Yeah.
Fran O'Toole was the lead singer with Ireland's most popular group, the Miami Show Band.
I didn't even know your name. I didn't care because I was sexy.
Fran and the Show Band were household names, playing to packed audiences on both sides of the border. Most of the Loyalist victims would have been unknown outside their immediate community. Their names would appear and then be forgotten. The UVF planned to change all that.
You gotta smile a little more. I wasn't meant to be a mover.
Fran and the band had been playing in the north in Banbridge and were heading home to Dublin. Just outside Newry, they were stopped at a checkpoint. One of the band members was Stephen Travers.
They started joking with us, asking us how the gig went and saying, I bet you'd rather be at home than be here. You'd rather be at home in bed. Obviously, joking with them. And Brian McCoy, who was the trumpet player, singer in the band, nudged me and said, don't worry, Steve. He said, this is an army checkpoint.
But it wasn't. It was the UVF masquerading as soldiers. Two of them planted a bomb in the back of the show band's van. It seems they intended it to explode across the border so the world would think the band were terrorists.
The bomb went off when they closed the back of the personnel van and instantly killed the two guys that were standing at the van. One of them had just pushed me.
The explosion threw Stephen Travers in the air. The UVF then shot him with dum-dum bullets. They exploded inside him, shattering into 13 pieces.
The next thing I remember was I could hear Fran O'Toole and I think Tony Garrity, who was my best friend in the band. We were very close. He was the lead guitarist. Crying, saying, "Please don't shoot me, don't kill me." And then I heard the gunfire, so they killed him, obviously. I was told later that they, as I say, Fran was the good-looking lead singer, and they shot him 22 times in the face.
Two of the UVF men arrested for the massacre were soldiers of the Ulster Defence Regiment, part of the British Army. They were sentenced to life in the compounds of Long Kesh. Once inside, they joined other loyalists who regarded themselves as prisoners of war and acted just like them. This remarkable film was secretly shot by the UDA and smuggled out of the prison. Parades and inspections like this were routine. UVF prisoners did the same under the command of Gusty Spence.
It was all known British Army lines. There was a regime, a regiment, that Revali was 8 o'clock in the morning, 5 mile run or 3 mile run, depending on the weather, and then showers, breakfast, muster parade. And then the day was laid out.
When I first met him, I marched into his makeshift office, if you like. He's dressed totally in black with a Sam Brown and a belt and a cap comforter. And he's a figure of authority. He's charismatic.
Spence knew that loyalist prisoners had one fatal flaw. They knew all about guns and bombs, but nothing about history and politics.
What I wanted to do was to provoke them into thinking about why they were there. Not defense. Defense was only the manifestation of why they were there. I wanted to know the reasons why they were there.
I think what happened to me was someone unlocked the door, pushed it slightly ajar, and gave me the offer to walk through the door or not walk through the door, as was my choice. And the person who unlocked the door was none other than Gusty Spence, who, when I arrived in Long Kesh, said to me, "Why are you here?" And I said, "Well, possession of explosives." And he says, No. "Why are you here?" And I thought, arrogant bastard, without defending my people. But it was a question, I think, that caused me some concern, because I don't know that I'd thought very long about why I was doing what I was doing and why I subsequently ended up in jail.
Long Kesh became the Loyalist University and David Irvine one of its graduates. In these classrooms sat the men who, almost 20 years later, became the new Loyalist politicians. They encouraged the paramilitaries on the road to peace.
We had to give people a grasp of our history. They didn't really have a clue initially.
They hadn't a clue why they were there?
No, they had it in political terms. No, they were absolutely ignorant.
What effect did prison have on you? Did it change you?
I think there's no road to Damascus conversion from paramilitarism to politics, but I think that the beginning of the analysis was as good for me as anything that's ever happened to me in my life. I don't advocate prison for reflection, but it's certainly the place to do it.
But outside the prison, on the raw streets of the Shankill, the rhetoric of soldiers fighting a war often cloaked naked sectarianism and blind hatred. A gang known as the Shankill Butchers epitomized that reality. They were members of a UVF platoon who abducted Catholics at random and literally carved them up with butcher's knives. When families identified the victims, it was a moment of unimaginable horror.
It was a very harrowing experience, and something that I'll, you know, probably never forget. I looked at this safe that was before me, and the physical state of the body, the injuries, stab wounds, his head was caved in, his face was just striped with massive cuts that had been stitched, his throat had been cut, he'd been stabbed in various places all over the body, there was hatchet and hammer wounds on the legs and thighs. And I was just standing there scanning this and trying to sort of come to terms with this thing that was in front of me.
And it was your father?
Yeah.
The orgy of killing began with a robbery at a wine warehouse in which three Catholics were shot dead. One member of the UVF platoon to which the Butchers belonged was questioned about the robbery. He was never charged and was never one of their gang.
I regarded them as a decent bunch of lads. I, like everything else in life, there are maybe one or two out of that group who would have found their way in the prison anyway. But I would say 70% to 80% of those charged with the Shankill Butchers would probably went through life without even being in prison themselves.
But how can you call them a decent bunch of lads when they committed the horrendous crimes that they did?
I still find them a decent bunch of lads. I knew them not as people who were monsters, I knew them as human beings.
They carved people up, tortured them, slaughtered them. Decent bunch of lads?
Well, in every bunch of lads, you have ones who are the leaders and ones who are led, and quite a few of them are led. And they remain to this day decent fellows.
Gorman McMullen was later charged with armed robbery and sentenced to 6 years. For months, whilst the gang stalked the streets, Catholics were terrified to venture out. When the Butchers were finally caught, they were convicted of 19 murders and sentenced to 2,000 years. But the families of their victims are still imprisoned by the memory.
In my opinion, when his heart stopped beating and his pulse stopped, he was no longer a victim. It was then that me and my family became the victims and are still the victims some 23 years later.
But whilst the law took its course and brought the Shankill Butchers to justice, others believed that was not enough. Two of the leaders of the gang were shot dead. One, it is thought, by the IRA, the other by a relative of one of their victims.
You surprised the Butchers weren't stopped?
No.
Why not?
Because of the then platoon leadership.
They just let it go ahead?
I don't think they had the bottle to stop them.
The bottle?
The guts. I
at one stage actually tried to commit suicide, where I cut my own throat and subsequently ended up on a life support machine, and from there into a mental institution.
Why did you try and cut your own throat?
I'm not a psychologist, so I can't... I have my own opinion, and I think that it was definitely linked to my father. I think in some way, subconsciously, I might have wanted to know how it really felt.
By the mid-70s, the British felt they'd tried every political initiative, and all had failed. Given that there was no immediate prospect of progress, the Labour government of the day put politics on hold and made security the number one priority. Suspects were arrested, interrogated by the police, and sentenced by special courts. The change of policy did produce results as the killings began to decline. For the first time, the government believed it had the terrorists on the run.
But the IRA was determined to show that it was not finished, with two devastating attacks, both on the same day. In County Sligo, it killed the Queen's cousin, Lord Mountbatten, blowing up his boat. Three others died with him.
I remember the day. I remember it well, because that night, our unit of the Ulster Volunteer Force had a meeting. And that night we decided that we were going to retaliate.
That same afternoon, the IRA killed 18 soldiers in two bomb attacks at Warren Point. Most of them were members of the Parachute Regiment. It was the Army's biggest single loss of life in the conflict. Loyalists were shocked at the audacity of these twin attacks on the Crown and its forces. The UVF was bent on retaliation. The target they selected was a Catholic man called John Patrick Hardy.
The next day, I went and I picked a motorbike up and a hand gun. And we drove into a street called Iston Street, where this man Hardy lived. The propellant passenger got off the motorbike and fired two shots, get back on the motorbike, and we made our escape.
Did you see what happened, what he did?
No, I heard gunfire.
You went to the door and rang the bell?
Rang the door.
And the man's daughter answered it?
I don't know if he answered it. I heard the gunfire and...
Then Mr. Hardy came to the door and was shot dead in front of his children?
I don't know.
That's what happened. Quite
right. I didn't know what that happened.
How would you feel if you remember that family? Somebody came to the door, your child answered it, and you were shot dead?
Anger, hatred, before hatred.
You didn't feel, didn't feel any emotion?
No.
Any pity?
No.
For the man who was shot dead?
No.
John Dillon was sentenced to life for the murder of John Patrick Hardy.
After you carried out the killing, what did you do?
Went home.
How did you feel?
Okay. Normal.
No anxieties, no worries?
No.
No remorse?
No.
Did you celebrate?
No. I don't believe in celebrating over anyone's death. I'm a soldier, I don't need to celebrate over there.
Inside the Mays prison at the start of the 1980s, 10 Republicans starved themselves to death in the great IRA hunger strike. They refused food, insisting they were prisoners of war and not common criminals. One after another, they joined the hunger strike. They said they would only end it once the government granted their demands. As IRA prisoners prepared to die, tension in the Loyalist community became unbearable.
The hunger strike was a period when people again expected war. My whole mentality at that time would have been, preparing for war.
The turning point in the hunger strike was the death of Bobby Sands. Sands had just been elected as a Westminster MP. To loyalists, the tens of thousands who walked behind his coffin were all supporters of the IRA, poised to destroy Ulster.
People at that time thought that the Protestants were fearful of what was going to happen, that this was going to be an uprising, they were all going to be slaughtered.
Loyalist fears of doomsday were heightened when they saw the British and Irish prime ministers working in harmony to bring London and Dublin closer together. Billy Giles was from a Loyalist family in the shadow of the shipyard in East Belfast. His father and three brothers had all joined the British Army. Billy had originally joined the UVF, but drifted away. Fearing the growing strength of the IRA and the growing links with the South, he became involved in the UVF once again. He was now ready, in his eyes, to defend his community by taking reprisals for Republican violence.
Who was the target?
Target was a candidate, man. Guy that seen me as myself. Didn't matter who it was to me, like. Didn't matter. It wouldn't matter who it was.
But you were supposed to be non-sectarian.
I know.
What had changed?
Everything went out the window. My whole being took until that time was away. That's just the way it affected me. You can ask me how it affected me, Peter, and I'm telling you that's how it affected me personally. What would have been crossed before as a decent young man suddenly turned into this. And that's the way, what Northern Ireland and what the environment I was living in, that's the effect it had on me.
What did it turn you into?
It turned me into a killer.
His victim was a workmate and friend. His body was found in the boot of his own car. Billy Giles had shot him through the head. At Hillsborough Castle, Mrs. Thatcher further cemented the relationship between the two governments. She signed the Anglo-Irish Agreement with the new Irish Prime Minister, Dr. Garrett Fitzgerald. The agreement gave Dublin a direct involvement in the affairs of Northern Ireland.
Straight down and
I didn't get home until evening for dinner, and my teenage children were watching television, and they were all looking pretty stunned and quiet. And I said, "What's happened?" And they said, "Oh, Mrs. Thatcher's handing us over to Dublin." I said, "What?" I didn't know she was here in Northern Ireland. And I said, "I must watch the news." And I said, "But I'll tell you one thing. Mrs. Thatcher's the Prime Minister today, but she'll not be the Prime Minister forever. But we've been in Northern Ireland for 300 years, and we'll be here when she's gone."
Tens of thousands of loyalists gathered in the biggest demonstration the city had seen since 1912. Then Sir Edward Carson pledged that Ulster would never surrender to Dublin by accepting home rule. Loyalists saw Paisley as Carson's successor.
Thatcher tells us that republic must have some say in our province. We say never, 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 never.
What Paisley had prophesied over all these years now seemed to be coming true.
What did the Anglo-Irish Agreement represent to you?
Complete surrender of Ulster's position. For the first time, the Prime Minister of the Irish Republic had a real say in the internal affairs of Northern Ireland.
Loyalist areas erupted. Hundreds now rushed to join the paramilitaries. They believed their leaders when they spoke of the sellout.
What effect did it have on the UDA?
Now, for a start, they gained hundreds of recruits. It was a complete betrayal as far as we could see. But the UDA did benefit from the point of view that hundreds of young people swelled the ranks.
Loyalist youths attacked the police, believing that the RUC was upholding the agreement. The police held the line. Westminster was determined that this time Loyalist violence would not undermine the will of Parliament. But policemen were not only attacked on the streets, their homes were petrol bombed and their families intimidated. Loyalists knew where to find them because most policemen lived in their midst.
Why were you taking on the police and the army? Well, when they both represent the crown that you purport to be loyal to.
But we are. We always have been loyal. We've always been loyal to the crown, and we do want to remain British. But we just don't like people trying to take it from us, no matter what gaze we'd put it under.
You're attacking your own police force, intimidating policemen out of their houses, burning their houses.
Exactly. But that was a sign of the times too, Peter, because this was a unique situation where no one had experienced this before. This was getting really, really serious here. We thought that the Anglo-Irish agreement, and young fellows thought the Anglo-Irish agreement signalled the death of Ulster, that it was only a matter of years down the road before we're in the United Ireland.
Inside the Ulster Hall, the citadel of loyalism, a body was launched to organise opposition on a province-wide scale. Loyalists flocked to hear of a new organisation. It was called Ulster Resistance. Ian Paisley gave the movement his blessing.
I make a personal appeal to you as a political leader in this province. I am tempted to give this movement of Ulster Resistance my undivided support. I will give it whatever political cover.
Ulster Resistance was to be a citizens' army to defend the province against the IRA. But it was to have a more sinister side. It needed arms, and the UDA and the UVF were ready to help procure them.
How was the money to buy the arms obtained?
It was through racketeering, robberies, bank robberies.
Jackie MacDonald was sentenced to 10 years for blackmail and threatening to kill.
Nobody else is going to come along and say, there's X amount of pounds, I know you need a few AK-47s, or I know you need weapons to defend your country. Nobody is going to come along and say, there you are, there's a few pounds for you.
To raise the money, the UDA robbed a bank in Portadown, getting away with over £300,000. The UVF had set it up. Ulster Resistance now had the money. The next step was to buy arms.
Everything was in place. Channels had been opened, everything was in place. To bring the weapons in, it just needed the final payment. And within a couple of months of the bank robbery being done, the stuff was delivered.
The arms came from the Lebanon. Ulster Resistance organised the purchase. But roughly a third of the consignment was intercepted by the police. Their suspicions were aroused by the sight of two heavily laden Ford Granadas with their mud flaps on the ground and their noses in the air. The weapons had been split three ways. Most of the UDA's share was lost. Some of the UVF's weapons were also later recovered. Thought that Ulster Resistance's share is still largely intact. Paisley, who'd initially donned the beret of Ulster Resistance, insisted he knew nothing about the weapons and immediately withdrew his support.
When you were involved with Ulster Resistance also became involved with the Loyalist paramilitary.
And immediately that happened.
With the UVF and the UDF.
And immediately that happened, we dissociated ourselves.
And they started
completely
procuring arms.
Yes.
Robbing the bank.
Yes, well, we were dissociated from it at that time.
But if you're setting up a resistance movement, presumably you have to buy arms to arm the resistance.
No.
You shouldn't have been surprised they went out to buy arms.
No, you read the pledge to Ulster Resistance. Read the pledge to it. And you'll find that the pledge was no different from what Lord Carson got his people to sign.
Lord Carson armed his troops.
That is right.
Ulster Resistance was in the business of arming its troops. You can't resist without arms.
No.
So you go and get arms.
No, but we did not
then you
say...
Them.
No, we did not say that we were going to arm them. They knew perfectly well that there would be no packing.
Now fired by opposition to the Anglo-Irish agreement and equipped with a new arsenal of weapons, the Loyalist paramilitaries and their army of new recruits were ready to take the offensive.
They wanted to kill Republicans. Got beyond the stage where they wanted to defend the area. They just wanted to go and attack Republicans or Republican areas.
And kill Catholics as well?
Unfortunately, kill Catholics as well.
For many Loyalists, killing Catholics was easy. They pulled the trigger and then went home. But not so Billy Giles. He could not live with what he had done.
When it happened, it felt to me that somebody had reached down inside me and ripped me inside it. That's what it felt like. It felt as if somebody just put their hand down and through my head and just ripped. You know, seriously. I felt amper. You hear a bang, it's too late. You hear a bang and that's it. It's too late now. You've went somewhere you've never been before and it's not a very nice place. And you can't stop it. It's too late now.
Did you ever come back from that place?
No. Never felt a whole person again. Never felt like anything. See, I lost something that day. Don't think I'll bring it back.
Billy Giles graduated while in the Mays prison. He was released after serving 15 years. Last September, he hanged himself. He left behind a suicide note. "I was a victim too," he wrote. "Please let our next generation live normal lives. Tell them of our mistakes and admit to them our regrets. I've decided to bring this to an end now. I'm tired."
Peter Taylor.